Hey, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to continue on with the discussion I was having about the chemtrails and genetically modified GMO'd wheat and all these kind of things they're doing in the United States. You know, brothers and sisters, it's just so simple. I mean, genetically modified fruit and trying to change the second heaven, I mean, hey, that's the same thing as the days of Noah. You know, when you have the fallen angels sleeping with the daughters of men, you end up with a genetic modification, brothers and sisters, as I've been talking about in videos over 2 or 3 years, as the Lord has showed me, really, that when someone takes the mark, it would alter their DNA. In other words, they would become a Giborim, as the Bible tells us. I'm just reviewing some things here and connecting it. If you have seen it, you know that. The Bible tells us that Nimrod, you know, which is obviously probably the greatest biblical type of Antichrist. The Pharaoh is too, dealing with Moses. But Nimrod tried to make a name for himself. In other words, he tried to be his own God. He tried to make a way to heaven. That's the thing about the Tower to Heaven. One time I had an atheist relative who got saved before he died. And he said, well, it's hard for me to believe in the Bible because, and I was a new pastor at the time, and I went to pray for him because he's an alcoholic. And he found out he had stomach cancer. He said, it's hard for me to believe the Bible because God destroyed the Tower of Babel, and then they build skyscrapers all the time now, and God doesn't do anything about it. You know, so when I was new in the ministry, the reason why, you know, if you've watched my videos, the Lord keeps giving me all these nuggets of wisdom is because when people would ask me those crazy questions, instead of just explaining it away, I would go pray and seek God. You know, and I read in the Bible where King Solomon asked God for wisdom, and God said, because you asked me for this and not riches and all these other kind of things, I'm going to bless you with wisdom and all of those other things, you know, a healthy life and long life and wisdom, financial blessings and all these things. So, you know, I was really led from the beginning to always keep asking the Lord for wisdom. Lord, give me wisdom, Lord, in the Bible about you, you know, Lord, that I might know you better and understand you better. Like Moses, who had done all these things for God, when he got to the mountain and he got a chance to talk to God and got the Ten Commandments, the thing he asked God, of all the things Moses could have asked, he said, Lord, show me your glory that I might know you better and know how to serve you better and understand you. You know, reveal yourself more to me. You know, and in that you get wisdom, not earthly wisdom, but the wisdom of God. And then the Lord will also bless you with earthly wisdom. It is as above in the third heaven as below. You know, God told Moses, you know, make the tabernacle with the ark in it and all that after the pattern I showed you on the mountain. So Moses was able to see all these things in heaven and then make them on earth. So let thy will be done in heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. So we are created in the image of God. God's in heaven. He created us in his image here on earth. So the third heaven, what the Bible calls the third heaven, where God dwelleth and where we are, that's where in the image of that. But so Satan being a mockery of that, which I wrote about this in the book, brothers and sisters. If you want to know further about it, ask me and get a copy of the book where I went into all this detail about it, but I'm just touching on it now to get to where the Lord is leading me to talk about in this video, you know, to lay it out, because many of you maybe don't, you wouldn't know what I was talking about. So Satan being a mockery of God, you know, of course, from the very beginning, his real goal, Satan's goal is to stop God's word from coming to pass, starting with Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, and God said that the seed of the woman, the Messiah, would crush the head of the seed of the serpent. So since the very beginning, you know, Satan has tried to thwart that prophecy of God. You know, even before that, of course, he in his rebellion, and then he came down and tempted Eve and got man to fall to stop God's purposes and plans. And God knows this. Satan is really the controlled opposition, and God allows these things so that we have free will and have a choice. Adam and Eve had a free will, even though they were living in a sinless life. They had a free will. We have a free will. The angels had a free will. You know, people get confused and, you know, angels have a free will. Now, the reason why an angel can't be forgiven is, like the angels in the Old Testament, they sinned. They kept not their first estate. They decided they wanted to be as a man and have sexual relations with women. And the reason why they can't be forgiven is because they've already been there to heaven. You know, they weren't like us. We're born in a world and we're not with God, and we're in darkness, and we're, you know, we're down here, and so We have an excuse. God created it where we have an excuse because we're ignorant. We don't know any better until God would choose to reveal himself to us through someone preaching to us or even a divine epiphany, revelation, or whatever, how God would reveal himself to, hey, you know, I made a way for you, one way, and it's not a tower in Babylon. In the plain of Shinar, that was before Babylon. It was a tower of Babel there in the plain of Shinar, which is where Babylon was later on. Same place. So it says that Nimrod, like I said, is the greatest type of the Antichrist. He became a mighty hunter in the King James. But when I used to read that, and it talks about the giants being men of renown, men of old. I mean, when you read it in the King James, it sounds like they're cool. The fallen angels' children, the Nephilim, the giants, were cool. You know, so that makes them sound good in the King James. When you read about, you know, because it's been 500 years in the different way of using words. And then you got Nimrod, it says he became a mighty hunter. It sounds like, hey, he was a great hunter. But that's not what the text is saying in Hebrew. It says he became a gibor. Just as the Nephilim, they are gibor. So a mighty man. In other words, they, you know, they were giants, they were powerful. But those Nephilim were the fruit of a fallen angel, angels who fell. Of course, Satan being their leader, Azazel, another name, the scapegoat from when they would send the scapegoat into the wilderness, just FYI there. They named him Azazel, same name. Satan wanted to thwart the plan of God, so he corrupted the DNA line. He wanted to corrupt the DNA so there'd be no humans left, so there would be no seed of a woman. There would be no pure woman to have a seed, to have a Messiah, to bring forth the Messiah, the Son of God. That was the whole plan. All those things that happened with the giants and the promised land and when the Israelites came out of Egypt, all those things were all designed to thwart the birth and the coming forth of the Messiah. Today, when you got the Muslims trying to occupy the Temple Mount and all that stuff, the mosque up there and all that is a controlled opposition. God, you know, the God is allowing that because he doesn't want the Jews to do the Old Testament blood sacrifices all this time in the church age because it's an abomination to the blood of Christ. God gave them one generation from about 33 AD until 68 AD to 70 AD. Then the temple was destroyed. They haven't been able to do blood sacrifices since then, really because it's an abomination to the blood of Christ. And also now God is setting it up for the return of the Messiah. So, of course, Satan wants to thwart the return of the Messiah, the rule and reign on earth, and throw him into the, you know, into the bottomless pit and all those things. Of course, he's trying to thwart that. That's why he's got that dome of the rock up on the Temple Mount. That's why they build where the Bible says that Jesus would walk through the eastern gate when he lands. Zechariah chapter 14, it says the Messiah will return. He'll land up there on the Mount of Olives. There'll be earthquake. The mountain will split in twain. And the Lord would walk in through the Kidron Valley into the Eastern Gate. Well, of course, the Muslims have built their cemetery right there. So, you know, that Jesus being, you know, under the law in the Old Testament, he lived as a rabbi under the law. Of course, he would be defiled by walking through that graveyard. Any Jewish person who are following the law of Moses would be defiled by walking through that graveyard into the Eastern Gate. So that's what they think they're doing. And the Eastern Gate has been sealed all this time, you know, waiting for it to be opened by the Messiah. But of course, when the earthquake happens, all that will be removed. Obviously, God will make a way to deal with the Temple Mount, with a dome of the rock and all that stuff. None of that stuff's going to stop Jesus from returning. You know, just like all the things he did in the Old Testament, it wouldn't stop. Even, you know, like Judah not giving his daughter-in-law Tamar to his youngest son after two of his sons had died, he was afraid to give his daughter-in-law to his youngest son because he thought he might die too. So God even made a way and allowed Tamar to present herself as a prostitute, that Judah himself would sleep with her because he had denied her of her lawful right to his youngest son. They had a child, and that child is in the bloodline of Jesus, Peleg. He is in the bloodline of the Messiah. There's also a real prostitute from Jericho, the one who tied the scarlet thread that her house wouldn't be destroyed. She is also in the Rahab, the harlot. She's also in the bloodline of the Messiah. So God uses all people, you know, any people. There's more Gentiles, and there's another Gentile, at least in the bloodline of the Messiah. Of course, that's Ruth from the book of Ruth. She's also, you know, married to Boaz, the great-grandfather of King David. That's also the bloodline of the Messiah. So God has many things, brothers and sisters, to overcome all of the obstacles that would come up against his word that Satan would try to throw out there. So Nimrod became unlike the fallen angel's seed and the human woman's seed, just like the square and compass of masonry. The square and compass of masonry is as above, so below. That's the motto of them. You see that Baphomet, as above, so below, holding his hands. Second heaven, what's done on, what let Satan's will in the second heaven be done on earth as it is in the second heaven. It's, you know, as a mockery of God. There's even a naked statue of George Washington wearing a toga doing the Baphomet symbol of as above, so below. You see Madonna doing it and all that. Of course, Madonna's a moron. She doesn't know what she's talking about. She's a retard. She's just being used by Satan. She's a total loser in this Kabbalah. And, of course, lots of people are trying to credit prophecies to Kabbalah. Kabbalah is Satanism. All the New Age demonic mess is coming from Kabbalah, brothers and sisters. Even the Rothschilds and all them, they're Kabbalists. Satan worshipers, Luciferians. That's, you know, the top Illuminati people. That's where it's coming out of. Kabbalah, Kabbalism. That is mystic, demonic lies. Anything they say is words. It's what Satan wants to be put out, brothers and sisters. And they're a spirit of Antichrist. They deny that Jesus came in the flesh and that Jesus is the Messiah. It's Antichrist. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that's the root of it. Go look, you know, be leery of that. When you hear these people promoting something that something came from Kabbalah, it's from Satan himself. It's the ultimate, you know, the tree of life stuff, all that stuff that is satanic. You only look at that if you want to see, hey, what's Satan trying to do? You know, which could turn out, you know, it's a lie anyway. It's truth mixed with lies, all that kind of stuff. Anyway, so Nimrod was different than those children of the fallen angels who were giants and Nephilim. Giborim is the plural of Giborah. Giborah is singular. In Hebrew, you add the I-M and it becomes plural, like Elohim. Eloi, Elohim is the plural of Eloi. So the plural is Giborim. So it says that Nimrod became a Gibor. He became a Nephilim. He became a mighty hunter. He had his DNA changed somehow, you know, by satanic rituals or some fallen angels, you know, Satan did it to him as a type of the Antichrist. He was building that tower. Of course, you know, you can't literally go to heaven through a tower. Of course, Satan's people are stupid. You know, they're retarded. They're blinded by God. So he thinks he can literally build a tower to heaven. But what is he doing? What does it really mean about him building the tower? It's not, it says they were trying to make a name for themselves. So as I prayed about it, the Lord revealed to me for my relative who was dying. He had stomach cancer. He was atheist. He was dying. He got saved. From this one thing that led him to salvation was this question, you know, that I'm talking about right now, you know, about them building that tower. Why did God destroy that tower and not modern day skyscrapers? Because it says, let us make a name for ourselves. What they were trying to do, brothers and sisters, was trying to make a way to heaven. And the Bible tells us there's one way to heaven. And Jesus, John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. Now, in the Old Testament, Before Moses and all that, with Abraham and all those guys, and even back to you know, Cain and Abel, they offered a blood sacrifice. Who started that? Of course, God. That's a whole other video, but I'll throw that out there as the Lord is leading me with these nuggets. What happened when Adam and Eve sinned? And this is probably the biggest evangelistic sermon I do when I'm in the Philippines, because they don't know much of the Bible. They know about Adam and Eve. They know about the mark of the beast, 666. They everybody knows that. So what did Adam and Eve do? They sinned. They saw they were naked. What did they do? They tried to cover their nakedness with fig leaves. Now, a fig leaf is not really doing so much, and then also it can blow off, and then it's going to wither, and it's not really good for covering you. So what did God do? God killed an animal, the first thing to die in the garden. God slayed an animal, and he took the skin and covered them, representing that God would cover our nakedness, that the shedding of the blood of that animal was a sacrifice God was willing to make for all you people that love animals more than humans. God was willing to sacrifice an animal because animals can't sin. Animals have no spirit in the image of God, and they cannot sin. They are not equal to humans. Now, it's from the New Age movement and from Satan that tries to say animals are equal or greater than humans. That is the Antichrist message too, about worshiping Mother Earth and loving, you know, overly exalting animals to be equal to humans. FYI. So that's truth, and I don't care who likes it or not. That's truth. So God took the skins of an innocent animal and the blood of that innocent animal, not to remove our nakedness, but to cover our nakedness, aka our sin. He covered it. So throughout the Old Testament, and even tells us specifically in Hebrews, all those animal sacrifices covers our sin. Just like the lambskins covered the nakedness of Adam and Eve. But then, and that's in the natural, and of course, as above, so below, in the natural they were covered, and then their sins were covered in the eyes of God through animal sacrifice, brothers and sisters, until the time, as it tells us clear in Hebrews, you know, Jesus, who is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, as John the Baptist said, his blood removed sin. It covered all of those animal sacrifices. Blood done in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was counted under the blood of Christ, so that all of those sacrifices were credited to the blood of Christ, as the book of Hebrews tells us, so that sin became removed, not just covered, but removed, thereby opening the way to heaven. Before that, brothers and sisters, no one was in heaven. People were in Sheol, as it's called in the Bible. They were in there in the bosom of Abraham with a great gulf between them and hell. The Bible tells us that hell is increasing, and that the Lord Jesus led captivity captive. He preached. He descended into Sheol, not to hell where the evil people are. Jesus descended into Sheol where that bosom of Abraham was, and he told those people the gospel. They got saved, Abraham and all those guys. And then, because their sins were not covered, but removed, then, after the blood of Jesus became into effect, after the crucifixion of Christ, the blood of Jesus became in effect, and the new covenant began. And then, all of the Old Testament saints, their sins were removed by the blood of Christ. That's why if you read in the Gospel of Matthew, brothers and sisters, at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, you will see that many of the Old Testament saints were seen walking around in Jerusalem. A lot of people don't know that because they never read their Bible. They didn't pay attention. There was a resurrection of those Old Testament saints, and they were seen by many people walking around in Jerusalem as before they ascended on up to be in heaven for the first time. Heaven became occupied by the saints for the first time, brothers and sisters, because only because of the blood of Yeshua, not by the blood of goats and bulls. That's why you can never put your faith in the law, because if the law was sufficient for us, as Paul tells us, if the law is sufficient for us, why did Jesus have to die? Why did God send his only begotten Son? Because the law was not sufficient to remove our sins, but only to cover our sins through the animal sacrifice system as a bridge from humanity to the Messiah. Brothers and sisters. And so that's what we're dealing with right now. There's a bridge to the return of Christ, and then there's a bridge of the return, or the manifestation of the Gibborim, of the Nephilim, of the Antichrist. And the signs that we can see of what the devil's doing is the genetically modified corn, genetically modified stuff, the chemtrails, all these things trying to modify God's creation in the natural. Satan always works in the natural. God works in the spiritual from the inside out. Satan tries to work from the outside in. Hey, that's a good nugget there. You know, when you see the beer commercials, you see all these babes wearing almost like a thong and a scantily clad bikini and some dudes out there drinking a Budweiser and they're having a great time, right? They don't ever show you, you know, a bunch of 60-year-old losers, man, waiting on the liver transplant list because they were alcoholics, you know, with all their teeth rotten out and, you know, and a big old beer gut, and then, some old woman with a rolling pin chasing him around. They don't show you that, the final result of alcoholism. They don't show you that result with the Marlboro man. You know, the Marlboro man died of lung cancer, and he also had AIDS. As a matter of fact, most people don't know that the Marlboro man was a flaming homosexual who had AIDS also. And died of complications of AIDS, but he also had lung cancer from all of his smoking. So things are never as they seem with Satan, you know, to be a cool cowboy, but the end result is dying of lung cancer. You know, it was really more the Brookback Marlboro man. So brothers and sisters, the devil's always deceiving and tricking. So when you see the things that the devil's doing, that's why, you know, you can't really get into what's written on the inside of the pyramids and all this kind of stuff. That's all from the devil. Kabbalah, Egyptian pyramid writings and hieroglyphs and all that stuff. All that stuff is in the Aztec stuff and the 2012 and all that. That's not from God. That's Satan's message. And Satan is a liar. So there's truth mixed in there. We can look at it and say, hey, this is what the devil's trying to do. We can see the devil, you know, his, as I wrote in the book too, you know, Satan's plan for the ages. We can see his plan, but what we do is help, you know, use that information to build our strategy against him, to overcome to tell others, hey, look what's happening. Here comes a tsunami of satanic dung coming towards you. And this is how Satan is infiltrating your life and trying to destroy you, by looking at what the devil's doing. But it's not the gospel message, like, oh, I read, and you know, by looking at a folded up dollar, that the Hoover Dam's going to collapse. Well, Satan may have a plan to do that. That doesn't. Not, the message is not, you know, run from the Hoover Dam. The message is Satan's active and working in this world and trying to kill, steal, and destroy, as Jesus said. John chapter 10, the enemy cometh not but to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come, Jesus said, to give you life and life abundantly. So it's a contrast. That's what we're looking at, the contrast of what the devil's doing and what God's doing. And that's what we're trying to tell non-believers and all of these old sleepy Christians living in sin, backslidden, lukewarm, who think they're going in the rapture and think that, you know, they're saved. When in reality, they're just as blind, naked, poor as anybody else. And the Lord commanded the Laodicean church, Revelation chapter 3, to repent, turn from what you're doing. Wake up and repent and turn from your wicked ways, and God will give you life. Christ will give you life. It says, wake up, thou that sleepeth, and Christ will give you life. That's the message. Wake up, wake up, wake up. And that's the whole thing. There's so many people, brothers and sisters, on the internet who are getting all into the details, and their whole life is all about the chemtrails and genetically modified stuff and all what the devil's doing. And they're into it and studying it and trying to say, oh, this is going to tell us when the rapture is going to happen. The devil is a liar. They ain't going to tell you when the rapture is going to happen. It's to draw you away from Christ. Warning, warning, warning. These things are real. Flee from these things. Rebuke those things. Stay away from those things. Stop embracing the darkness. That's the children of the devil that are embracing that and presenting that as gospel and truth. It's from Satan. It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. If Satan can bring some things to pass, you know, and then other things not, people are like, oh, it's from Satan. Listen to the message. Listen to the message. Kill, steal, and destroy. Destruction. Destruction, destruction. It's that those things are from the devil, brothers and sisters. The message from God is repent because destruction is coming. The message from the devil is look at all these cool things you can get from looking at all these sources but the Bible. Go to everywhere but the Holy Spirit. Flip open almanacs. Look at tea leaves. Look at coffee grounds. Look at dollar bills. Look at pyramids. But don't look to Jesus. Don't look to the Bible. Don't look to the Holy Spirit. Let's use all of this necromancy. Let's use all of these outside sources. Brothers and sisters, those things are to look at for the warning. Warning to non-believers. This stuff is real. Satan is real. His power is real. His plans are real. But they're not going to... What am I trying to say? They're not going to happen. They're going to happen somewhat as God allows. It's controlled opposition. It's not truth. It's just plans of Satan. Ideas of Satan. That's why when you hear about all of the people that can be the Antichrist, you got the Maitreya. Because, oh, the Maitreya is Antichrist. He said he's the Antichrist. Benjamin Graham said that the Maitreya is going to rule the world and all that. That's what Satan, that's what that fallen angel speaking through Benjamin Graham is saying. And then another fallen angels are saying, oh, the Pleiadians and the aliens are coming, and that's what's going to happen. And then you got the satanic demons speaking through the Aztecs saying 2012 and the Mayans and all that 2012. All these fallen angels are just putting out all these different lies. There's a little bit of truth in all of them mixed up in there. The people that made the money, you know, they were inspired by Satan to put all this stuff on there. You can see that doesn't mean any of that's all from the devil. It's all from the devil. It's all from the devil, brothers and sisters. Satan can try all he wants, but unless God allows him to do it, ain't none of that stuff happening. Brothers and sisters, none of it stuff happening. It always goes back to putting your faith and trust in the risen Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. Put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and turn from the things of this world. It's a warning, warning, warning. Move away from the things of this world, brothers and sisters. God bless you as always. Keep your eyes on the Word of God. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Turn your heart and ask the Lord to fill you with His Holy Spirit. Turn away from all of this nonsense. Just take it as a warning and use it as a tool to win the lost.